Hello students, I am your educator Dr. Hina Devnani and today we are going to study chapter number 8 of 12th standard, that is Human Health and Diseases. This is the third part of the chapter. Two parts have already been discussed. This part is actually the most interesting part. Why? Because we are going to deal with two deadly diseases which have created a havoc in human life, that are AIDS and cancer. No proper cure and treatment have yet been discovered for these two diseases. So let's study AIDS first. You can see this is the symbol of AIDS given by NACO, National AIDS Control Organization. This is the virus that causes AIDS, that is HIV. What is the full form of AIDS? Acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. It is an acquired disease. Acquired disease means the disease that we get after birth. That means this is not a congenital disease. It is not present in our DNA. We do not get it from our ancestors. So this is acquired disease. This disease is immunodeficient disease. That means what happens in this disease? The immune system of a person is deficient. There is deficiency in the immune system. There is problem in the immune system. That's why this is known as immunodeficiency. And it is a syndrome. Syndrome means a group of symptoms. That means many symptoms are there. That's why it is called as syndrome. So that is the meaning of this full form. It is a condition acquired during the lifetime of an individual, referring to the fact that it is not a congenital disease. Syndrome means a group of symptoms. Okay, when was AIDS first reported? It was reported in 1981. And since then, it has spread all over the world. It has been almost 39 to 40 years and it has spread all over the world. More than 75 million people have already been affected by AIDS. And more than 35 million people have already been dead because of this disease. The causative agent of AIDS is HIV, that is human immunodeficiency virus. It is a member of a group of viruses which are called as retroviruses. Retroviruses generally have RNA as their genome and not DNA. Along with RNA, they also have a gene which is called as reverse transcriptase gene. The role of this gene will be explained later on. For now, you just have to remember that it has RNA genome and it has reverse transcriptase gene. Your homework for today is, here it's written AIDS was reported first in 1981. I want you all to find out who was the first person who got AIDS and he belonged to which country. That is the homework for today. Find out where and to whom was AIDS first reported. How is this HIV infection spread or transmitted? The first and the foremost reason is sexual contact. This is a sexually transmitted disease, so it can be infected or it can be transmitted by sexual contact. If a person is infected with HIV and if that person is having unsafe sexual practice with another person who is a healthy person, remember here, unsafe sex. If there is unsafe sexual contact with an infected person, it causes AIDS. It can also be transmitted by transfusion of contaminated blood and blood products. If the blood is contaminated, obviously this HIV remains in the blood. So if there is contaminated blood and that contaminated blood is transfused to some healthy person, then also this AIDS can spread. It can also be spread by sharing infected needles. As in case of intravenous drug abusers, drug abusers who take drugs with the help of needles, intravenous drugs, they inject the drugs inside their veins directly. So what these people do? They don't have so much of sense that they should use new needles every time, obviously. If they are taking drugs, that means they are not caring about their health enough. So why would they care of changing the needles every time? So what they do? They just share the needles with each other. So there are many chances of them getting this disease. And the fourth is the most dangerous way of transmission HIV, that is from infected mother to her newborn child, to her child through placenta. Now, which people are actually at high risk of getting this infection? Mostly individuals who are having multiple sexual partners, because most of the time they are even not knowing the history of their sexual partners. If they're having multiple sexual partners, that means most of their partners are unknown. So they are at higher risk of getting this infection. Drug addicts, as I told earlier, they don't care about their health much. So obviously they're not going to take care to change the needles. So they are at higher risk. And individuals who require repeated blood transfusions. In some cancers, blood cancers, in anemia when there is a deficiency of blood, and in thalassemia. So they require blood transfusions very often. So it may happen that sometimes they get the blood which is contaminated. And last, children born to an HIV-infected mother are at high risk of getting this infection. Now here I want you all to understand these few points which are related to AIDS. First important point is AIDS or HIV does not spread through mere touch or physical contact. This point everybody should understand, because this is a misconception in our society that if a person is having AIDS and if you just touch that person or use the towel of that person or clothes of that person, you may get AIDS. But that is not the case. By mere touch or physical contact, AIDS is not spread. It spreads only through contact with the body fluids. Yes, if there is contact of the body fluid, then the virus may spread. Now, why we want to know these two points? Because it is very important for the physical and psychological well-being of the person that is having AIDS. We should always take care that the person is already facing a lot of problems because of this disease. And if we don't understand important points, like it is not spreading through mere touch or physical contact, what we are doing, we are increasing the trouble of that person. We should not isolate that person from our family or society. This I have seen, I know that you might have also seen this, but if anybody hears that a certain person is having AIDS, they simply isolate that person, even from the family, from the society, from the village, or whatever. They just isolate that person and just send him to some centers or somewhere they send that person to lead a life on its own. But that should not be the case. Yes, we should take proper care, but this is the time when that person himself needs a lot of care from us. So I want you all to understand this thing. And please try to teach these things to the people who live nearby you, so that they can get knowledge about this and they can be aware of the disease. There always exists a sufficient time interval between the infection and appearance of symptoms. Suppose if a person is getting infection today, it may happen that the symptoms appear after few months or after 5 years or after 10 years. So the incubation period of this virus is very, very large. Now, how does this HIV affect the body? First of all, the virus enters the body of the person and it starts infection through the macrophages. As we have discussed earlier, that this virus has RNA as the genome. So what this virus does? The RNA genome of this virus replicates, and from RNA it forms viral DNA. See here, from RNA to DNA. We know that from DNA to RNA is known as transcription. And it happens with the help of enzyme transcriptase. But here reverse process takes place from RNA to DNA. That's why here the role of reverse transcriptase takes place. Now this viral DNA will enter the host cell's DNA. And what it will do? It will actually direct the cells, the DNA, to produce more virus particles. And slowly our cells, our macrophages, will become a factory of producing HIV. Many viruses. So what they will do, they will continuously keep on producing viruses. At the same time, HIV will enter into T lymphocytes also, helper T lymphocytes, and there also they will replicate and produce progeny viruses. These progeny viruses will be released in the blood and they will attack other T lymphocytes. So this entire cycle will continuously be repeated and it will lead to a progressive decrease in number of helper T lymphocytes. And we all know T lymphocytes are responsible. We have studied in second part, lymphocytes, T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes are responsible for our immunity. So here what will happen? As the number of T lymphocytes go on decreasing, our immunity will also deteriorate. During this period, the person will suffer from bouts of fever. That means the fever will come and fever will go continuously. This will happen. Cycles will be there. The person will also have diarrhea and weight loss. Due to decrease in the number of helper T lymphocytes, the person will start suffering from infections because their immunity has become weakened, right? So he will get many different infections that could have been otherwise dealt with by the immune system. This include diseases such as those caused by bacteria, especially mycobacterium, then by viruses, means other virus will attack, other bacteria will attack, fungi will attack, and even parasites will attack that person. The patient will become immunodeficient, and so that person will not be able to protect himself against those infections. See, this is the exact cycle. Let's start from here. This is the virus. It is penetrating a proper, nice, healthy cell. So it is coming here. Here what happens? The viral RNA, you can see here symbols. This is the symbol of viral RNA. Viral RNA by reverse transcriptase, this diamond shape is reverse transcriptase enzyme. And viral RNA will be converted to viral DNA. And see, it is going inside the nucleus of the healthy cell. And it gets incorporated in this cell, in this DNA. See, you can see here. Right? So now what will happen? Slowly and slowly transcription will start. And here, see, new virus, viral assembly is starting. New viral DNA, RNA will be formed. By transcription, new RNA will be continuously formed. And you can see here, small bud is being formed. So by the process of budding, see here, a new bud will be formed. This will get detached from here and new virus will be formed. So what will happen? This one cell, it is still having the viral DNA. So this one cell will keep on producing more virus, more and more virus, and more viruses will go and keep on infecting new cells. So this cycle will continue. Here you can see this has become a factory. See, one bud will be formed. Again, here new transcription will take place, new bud will be formed, and again this will go on. So this is the whole cycle by which AIDS can be spread. What are the symptoms of HIV infection? As I said, for few months to few years, there won't be any symptoms, but slowly and slowly, weight loss and fever will start. The person may have pharyngitis, there is infection of the pharynx layer, lymph nodes will swell, muscle weakness, liver enlargement, there will be rashes on skin, nausea and vomiting, spleen will enlarge, mouth will have sores, and even brain will be affected. There will be continuous headache. How can we detect AIDS? There are two techniques of detection. First is ELISA technique. The full form of ELISA is enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. It is a biochemical technique. It is used in immunology to detect the presence of an antibody or antigen. What they do, they take the sample and they try to study the sample whether antibodies have been formed in that sample or not. If there are antibodies against the virus, that means yes, the virus has affected the person. Okay, there is another test called as Western blot test, WB test. This is also done to confirm the results of ELISA. Suppose by ELISA, it is clear that yes, antibodies are formed. So another test is done so that this results can be confirmed. What are the treatment? As I told earlier, there is no treatment of AIDS. Yes, but antiretroviral drugs can be used, and by this, the lifespan of the patient can be prolonged. But it cannot treat the disease completely and it cannot prevent death. So if there is no cure, no treatment, what is the better option? The better option is to prevent the disease. It has no cure. So it is our responsibility to prevent it. How can it be prevented? There are first, the person should be aware of the methods, how it is transported or how it is transmitted from one person to another. And subsequently, the person should take measures like having proper and safe sexual practice. If the person is going for blood transfusion, there should be effective monitoring of that blood, proper check of that blood. If the mother is having, she should take preventive measures from the beginning itself. And of course, the needles, if a person is going for getting injections or something, the doctor should take care that every time new needle is used, So these are some of the measures by which AIDS can be prevented. Now, there are certain governmental and non-governmental organizations which are trying to limit the spread of this disease. You might have heard about NACO, that is National AIDS Control Organization. Along with NACO, non-governmental organizations, NGOs are also making efforts so that people understand what is AIDS and they know how to prevent it. WHO conducts a number of programs to prevent the spreading of HIV infection. One more thing is that suppose if a person gets AIDS, in our Indian society, this is the situation in most of the places, if a person is getting AIDS, he or she will try to hide it from the society so that he doesn't get neglected from the society. But this is a very wrong practice. If a person is at chance or if a person is having doubt that whether he or she may get AIDS, he or she should immediately go to the doctor and inform him. By this, what will happen? If it is the initial stage, it may be cured or it may be treated by the doctor. See, here are some prevention methods I've already told. Making blood transfusions safe from HIV, ensuring that only disposable needles are used, needles, syringes, public or private hospital or clinic, whatever it is. There should be free distribution of condoms. What are condoms? They are the physical barriers during sexual contact. What it will do, what condom does, it actually prevents the mixing of male fluid with female fluid. So if any person, whether it is a male or a female, if that person is having AIDS and if during sexual practice they are using condoms, it will prevent the mixing of the fluids and hence it will prevent the transmission of AIDS. Controlling drug abuse. If people are drug addicts, obviously they are not going to think of using disposable needles, so it is better that they don't take drugs. Advocating safe sex, as I said, use of condoms, and promoting regular checkups for HIV in susceptible populations. What is the role of society in preventing the spread of this disease? They should have sympathy for HIV and AIDS patients. They should not isolate him. Disclosure about the HIV status to prevent further spread. Suppose if a person is having HIV, he should go to the doctor and disclose it. He should not hide it from the other people. Cooperation and coordination between society and medical fraternity should be there. They should coordinate so that the disease is not spread further. So that was about AIDS. Let's talk about second deadly disease, that is cancer. Even cancer is not having any cure if it is in the third stage. In our body, cell growth and differentiation is highly controlled. We all know that. We have studied in 11th standard about cell cycle. We know that it is controlled, regulated. But what happens? Sometimes due to some reasons, we'll see what are the reasons afterwards. Due to some reasons, there will be breakdown of these regulatory mechanisms. And at this time, the normal cell will be converted to cancerous cell. Normally, the normal cells which are present in our body, they have contact inhibition capability. What is this contact inhibition capability? Suppose if a cell comes in contact with other cell, what it will do, it will inhibit the uncontrolled growth of another cell. This is in normal cells. But when normal cells are converted into cancerous cells, they lose the capacity of contact inhibition. As a result, what happens? Cancerous cells continue to divide and giving rise to masses of cells. When there is a large mass of cell, or there are many masses of cells, these masses are called as tumors. And after a certain period of time, tumors get converted into cancer. There are basically two different types of tumors. First one is benign tumor, second one is malignant tumor. What are these benign tumors? They normally remain limited to their original location. If there is a tumor in a certain tissue, that tumor will remain to that part only, and they do not spread to other parts of the body. They cause less damage. Treating this type of tumor is very easy by just removing that part of the tissue. But suppose if there is malignant tumor, what are these malignant tumors? They are a mass of replicating or proliferating cells. Continuously they will be replicating, they will be growing. proliferating cells, which are called as neoplastic or tumor cells. These cells grow very rapidly. Continuously, they will be growing, and very rapidly they will grow. They thus invade and damage the surrounding normal tissues also. They are growing in a certain place, but because they are having very fast and very rapid growth, they will damage the surrounding tissues. Now, as these cells are actively dividing and growing, it leads to starvation of normal cells by competing for vital nutrients. That is very obvious. So what will happen? Cells may be slowed from such tumors. It means they will be removed out from such tumors. And along with the blood, they will reach to some other sites. Now, wherever they get lodged, wherever they are stuck, what they will do? They will start forming a new tumor over there. That means the tumor from one place is transmitted to other place. This property of tumor is called as metastasis. You can see in this figure, this is a benign tumor. It is only in a certain tissue. The cells are not cancerous. When the tumor spreads, it forms cancer. But here the tumor is not spreading, so it is not cancerous and it will not spread. It will be here only. Whereas in this, you can see they have come out. The cells have come out because they are having rapid growth. So they have come out and they will be spread to some other parts of the body. What are the causes of cancer? Transformation of normal cells into cancerous cells, neoplastic cells, may be induced by different agents. These agents can be either physical agents, they can be chemical agents, or they can be biological agents. Whatever agents are there, if an agent causes cancer, that agent is called as carcinogen. Now let's see the examples. Example of physical agents are ionizing and non-ionizing radiations. Ionizing radiations like X-rays, gamma rays, non-ionizing radiations like UV rays, ultraviolet rays. What these radiations will do, they will cause DNA damage. And if there is damage in the DNA, it won't be able to control the cell cycle. And if it is not controlling the cell cycle, the cell will be converted into tumor. Chemical carcinogens are present in tobacco smoke. We have seen that in the advertisement, or you might have seen in the packets of cigarettes, it is written tobacco causes cancer, right? So in the tobacco smoke, there are carcinogens, and because of them, lung cancer can be caused. Even mouth cancer, the tobacco that people chew, that consists of carcinogens, and that can lead to mouth cancer. Biological agents are generally viruses. These viruses, because they cause cancer, they are called as oncogenic viruses. They have certain genes which are called as viral oncogenes, and these genes can convert a normal cell into oncogene, or we can call it as cancerous gene. Several genes called cellular oncogene or proto-oncogene have been identified in normal cells. Normal cells have cellular oncogene, which are called as C-onc. These cellular oncogenes are also called as proto-oncogenes. Proto-oncogenes are not cancerous, so they have been identified in normal cells. But when virus enters your viral oncogenes, they can be activated. These proto-oncogenes can be activated and they will become oncogenes. And when they become oncogenes, the normal cell will get converted to cancerous cell. So these are some of the agents: physical, chemical, and biological agents. How can cancer be detected? For cancer, early detection is very important. If the cancer is detected in third stage, it is impossible to cure it. So early detection is very essential so that it can be treated successfully. Cancer detection can be done by taking biopsy. Suppose if there is a suspicion, like the doctor is having some doubt that some tissue is having tumor, what the doctor will do? He will take the piece of that suspected tissue, cut it into thin sections, and then he will stain it. And after staining, what he will do? He will take the thin sections and examine it in microscope. This is known as biopsy. And when the tissue is studied inside the microscope, under the microscope, it is known as histopathological study of the tissue. So this can be done, biopsy can be done, and then histopathological study of the tissue can be done. Even blood and bone marrow tests can be done. If the doctor is having doubt that maybe the person is having leukemia, that is blood cancer. So the doctor takes sample of blood and bone marrow and then he performs certain tests. Radiography can be done, that is, x-rays can be used to find out whether the person is having tumor or not. CT scan can be done. CT, you might have heard, computed tomography. This technique also uses x-rays and it generates a three-dimensional image of any internal part of an organism. MRI can be done, that is magnetic resonance imaging. It involves using strong magnetic fields, and here non-ionizing radiations can be used so that any pathological or physiological changes in the living tissue can be detected. So by these certain techniques, it can be found out whether the person is having a tumor or not. Sometimes even antibodies can be found. Antibodies against cancer-specific antigens. These can be used. Like, remember in AIDS, we have studied ELISA. In ELISA also, antibodies were used to detect. Here also, antibodies can be used. Because antigens, here cancer-specific antigens will be there in our body. So our body will try to fight against these and our body will produce antibodies. So this test of antibodies can also be done. There are some techniques of molecular biology which can be also done to find out. To detect genes in the individuals with inherited susceptibility to certain cancer. When this molecular biology test will be done, when there is a doubt that the cancer may be inherited from the ancestors. Identification of such genes will be helpful in prevention of cancers. If the identification is done at an earlier stage, it will be better for the patient to prevent it. Suppose if there is history of cancer, if one or two persons in a family are having cancer, and if the doctor is having doubt that this cancer may be inherited, he can warn the person, the patient, even before the cancer arrives. So what that person will do, he will try to prevent cancer. Okay, they will be actually advised to carry out certain things so that exposure is avoided. Like they can avoid tobacco, smoke. They can avoid chewing of tobacco. They can avoid x-rays. They can avoid any ionizing radiations. So this can be done. What are the treatment of cancer? Treatment of cancer can be done by one or combination of different approaches. We might have heard this. You all might have heard this. These are very common terms. Radiation therapy, chemotherapy, immunotherapy, surgery. These are the four methods by which treatment can be done, in which chemotherapy is the most common one. Let's see one by one what happens in this. What happens in surgery? The part of the tissue having tumor is removed. What happens in radiation therapy? Tumor cells will be irradiated lethally. Radiations will be sent inside the body and the tumor cells will be irradiated. These radiations will be lethal. That means it will try to kill the tumor cells. But it also takes care that normal proper cells are not killed. Only the tumor is killed. What is chemotherapy? Chemotherapy means giving drugs, giving medicines to kill the cancerous cell. They can be specific for particular tumors. But as we all know, chemotherapy has some side effects like hair loss. Hair loss will be there. The hair from the whole body will be lost, as well as anemia. Now, only by a certain one or two treatment, the cancer cannot be treated. So majority of cancers are treated by using a combination of all the above methods. Tumor cells avoid detection and destruction by immune system. Therefore, they are treated with substances called biological response modifiers. Our normal immune system cannot kill tumor cells. So what do we need here? We need some extra response from our body. And this extra response is known as biological response modifiers. They are substances such as alpha interferons, which activate their immune system and help in destroying the tumor. What happens here? These alpha interferons are given to the patient so that the patient's immune system is activated. And that immune system will help in destroying the tumor when these things are going on. A normal biological response will never try to. It will try, it will make antibodies, but it will not be able to kill the tumor cells. So alpha interferons is very important over here. So that was all about AIDS and cancer, the two most dreaded disease of our Indian society or of the society in the world, because there is no cure in the whole world. Now, if you have any doubts regarding these two topics, you can contact me. Until that, take care and keep studying.